Well, good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. It is Christ the King Sunday. This is the last Sunday of the liturgical year. So it's kind of like New Year's Eve. And next week we start with Advent. So with that, let us begin with a word of prayer. Good and gracious God, we come today to worship you, to bring our stress and our burdens and lay them down. We pray for your guiding light in the coming months as we prepare for Jesus' birth. We thank you for this year of living out our faith and pray for another year of strength. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite you to please stand and join me in a confession of forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who calls us into an everlasting hope, who guides us to springs of the water of life, who enlightens us with the spirit of wisdom. One with the communion of saints in all times and places, let us confess our sin against God and one another. Take a moment of silent reflection. O God, our merciful Redeemer, we confess the ways we live only for ourselves. We fail to see you in our neighbor's face. We turn our ears from voices that cry out. We pass by the hungry and the oppressed. In your great mercy, forgive our sin and strengthen us for service to all in need. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you and for his sake. God forgives you all of your sin. Blessed are you. Rejoice and be glad, beloved people of God. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Take this time to share the peace with one another. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the reign of God, and for peace throughout the world, for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For your people here who have come to give you praise, for the strength to live your word, let us pray to the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of power and might, your Son shows us the way of service, and in him we inherit the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what is right and the strength to serve the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. This is Beautiful Savior in Norwegian.
A reading from Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As shepherds seek out their flocks when they are among their scattered sheep, so I will seek out my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries. And I will bring them into their own land, and I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the watercourses and in all the inhabited parts of the land. I will feed them with good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and they shall feed on rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak. But the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them with justice. Therefore, says the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Because you pushed with flank and shoulder and butted at the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide, I will save my flock and they shall no longer be ravaged. And I will judge between the sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. and I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. The word of the Lord.
Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with a song. Enter the gates of the Lord with thanksgiving and the courts with praise. Give thanks and bless God's holy name.
A reading from Ephesians. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 25th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep on his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' Truly I tell you, not as you did it to one of the least of these, who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those on his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me.' Then they will also answer Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or sick or naked or in prison and did not take care of you? And then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated and invite the kids to come forward for a children's message. You guys have a good Thanksgiving? Is it fun? Good food? Yeah. Well, have you ever heard someone say, just wait a minute? Someone ever said that? Yeah. And it's something we say a lot, but you know, there's a lot that can happen in a minute. I want you to try something. I want you to think of all your favorite foods. And I don't have my timer with me, I forgot it. So we're gonna do that, and it's 8:54 when it says 8:55. I'll ask you what you thought of. So let's think of different foods we like. Well, that was about a minute, not quite. What kind of foods did you think of? Yeah. What's your favorite foods? You can just call them out. Pizza, turkey, bacon, pumpkin pie. What else? Bacon, green beans. Bacon and green beans are good together too. How about ice cream? Anybody like ice cream? Yeah, I like ice cream too. Mashed potatoes? Anybody like mashed potatoes and gravy? Yum. Yeah. So, here's another question. Have you ever been hungry? I mean, not like hungry, I want to eat supper, it's time for supper, but like so hungry, you don't even know where the next meal's going to come. Like really, 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 really hungry. Yeah? Well, there are some folks who are really hungry, and they don't have food for today, or tomorrow, or the next day. And even though we have plenty of food in our world, there's a lot of people who are hungry. In fact, in that minute that we were thinking about food, 12 people died in the world from hunger. Isn't that crazy? That's just crazy. See, one day Jesus was speaking to all of his friends and people around, and he said, I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. And they said, well, when did we do that? We didn't do that. And he said, whenever you did it for someone who was hungry or thirsty, you did it unto me. So this Thanksgiving, we had a lot to be thankful for, and one of them was that most of us probably aren't that hungry, that we don't know where our food or water is going to come from, but we are called to do our best to share when we do encounter someone or when there is an opportunity to give. And so, when we do so, when we give to another person like that, we're giving to God also. We're giving to Jesus because he said, when you did that unto them, you did that unto me. So let's pray. Dear God, you've given us so much. May we be willing to share it with those in need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks. Some years ago, I was driving through on the highway through St. Cloud, Minnesota, and I needed to go to a store or something, so I took the exit to get onto a business road. And so I took the exit, and I needed to make a left turn. So I'm in the left turning lane. And I waited, and I waited, and I waited, and I waited, and the light never turned green. It was stuck on red. And as I was waiting, I thought to myself, you know, life can be like this sometimes. It feels like we're stuck in a no-turn lane with the light never changing to green. There's seldom signs that we're going to enter into such a predicament. It just sort of dawns on us one day when we realize that everyone seems to just be passing us by. And we feel this kind of aching feeling, like something isn't right. Why am I not moving forward in my life? Why do I feel stuck? And a kind of desperation sets in. Think about this story. Two cowboys. They're working a cattle one day, and one of them discovers that he's in trouble when a wild bull, with his head down and nostrils flaring, comes charging towards him. And the cowboy sees a deep hole in the ground, so he runs to the hole and hops in. And the bull passes by, and then the cowboy hops out of the hole. Well, the bull turns around and sees the cowboy and paws at the ground and starts dodging at the cowboy. So the cowboy jumps back into the hole. And the bull passed by even madder than he was before. And the cowboy jumps out of the hole. And the bull turns around and starts chasing him, and the cowboy jumps in the hole. And this goes on for a while, and the other cowboy's watching this from a distance, and he yells out, "Why don't you just stay in the hole?" And the cowboy says back, "I would, but there's a bear in the hole." Life can feel like that sometimes. There's a lot of great country songs that sort of spell out that predicament in life when we get sort of caught between a rock and a hard place, as the saying goes. There are many people who have experienced so much negative. So many times they've fallen and found themselves flat out on the ground, found themselves again and again stuck between a rock and a hard place. They come to a point where they just shut down. They just don't care anymore because it feels like that's the only way you're going to cope. There is a country song and it goes, "I've been down so long that getting up never crosses my mind." Yeah, it's a very real thing. Some of us have been knocked down so many times, have fallen so many times, that we just decide it's less painful to get back up, to risk going down again. I looked up the word apathy, because that's what that kind of reminded me of. Apathy, it means lack of feeling, lack of interest. Unresponsive, lack of enthusiasm, unmoved, lack of alertness. It's a response of giving up, and it usually is caused by great anxiety. This being stuck in a turning lane where the light never turns green. And it's an experience that individuals can have, it's an experience that families can have, It's an experience that organizations can have, such as the church. Matthew 25, 31 through 46 is the last of Jesus' teachings. From this point on, we enter what's called the Passion, the story of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. He begins chapter 26. The next lines begin, when Jesus had finished saying all these things, he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days, the Passover is coming, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified." Dr. David Lowe, a professor, and actually now he's senior pastor of Mount Olivet Lutheran Church, but he was my professor at one point. He wrote, "Perhaps Jesus says in this parable what he has been saying all along through his teachings and actions, and what he will soon say in and through his very own body, that God loves us and all the world so much that God has decided to identify with us fully and completely." So many of the things that Jesus is talking about in this third parable in chapter 25. So the last 3 weeks, we've done parable 1, parable 2, and now this is parable 3. So many of the things that he lists in here that was done to the least of these are actually done unto him in the Passion story. Here's how I make the connection. He was thirsty, and the soldiers gave him something to drink. He was a stranger, and Joseph of Arimathea welcomes him by placing Jesus' body in his family tomb. He was naked, and Joseph of Arimathea clothes his dead body in clean linens. Likewise, what is not done unto the least of these is also not done unto Jesus. He is stripped of his clothes. He dies crying of thirst. His disciple Peter denies knowing him, which is a kind of unwelcome. Neither group in this story, the ones doing onto and the ones not doing onto, have no idea whether they are or are not doing this. They don't know. There are many questions that we don't know. We don't know the answers to. Not really. For instance, I am often asked about the afterlife. Does heaven and hell exist? What do I need to do to go to heaven? And the thing about salvation is it has actually very little to do with the afterlife. Salvation has to do with our present living right now. When we emphasize salvation as a kind of fire insurance, I'm saved, so I'm good, then that's a problem. It's a problem for the church, and it's a problem for Christians. It holds us back because we get caught up in a game of calculations. If I do so many volunteer hours, then for sure I'm going to heaven. If I do this, or how many volunteer hours are enough for God? It's really not our call to make or estimate or calculate. In this parable, the king gathers all nations, everybody, all beings, and no one knows if they're a sheep or a goat, or when they did or did not do as he describes. So much of what Jesus teaches in the gospel has more to do with how human beings treat each other in the right now, day to day, than it does anything to do with life after death. What if God intends to redeem all of creation? There's a lot of scriptural support for that. And if that's the case, then salvation would be what goes on here between human beings one to another. Jesus' vision for us is more than just an internal, introspective, spiritual reality. It includes the well-being of our neighbor. That means that, yes, you can have spirituality as an individual. You can devote to introspective spirituality. But salvation demands community. For God offers every opportunity for people to see and receive grace. An authentic reception of grace is then reflected out into the community, into others. And so we need a community. We need relationship for the fruit of the Spirit to be lived out. Jesus said that anyone who hears God's word and does it is his sister, brother, or mother. And Paul writes that we as the church are in Christ and we are sisters and brothers. We are invited to relationship with one another. They use familial language. We're invited into relationship with one another as well as with God. It's an invitation issued to anyone of all manner of life. This parable is not intended for us to ask, which one am I? Am I living a right-sided life or a left-sided life? Personally, I love goats, so I hate the fact that the goats get the bad rap on this one. I think goats are pretty awesome. So it's not about that. It's not about, am I doing well? Am I doing enough? It's not about, how's it going right now? How's my calculations? How am I doing? The question in this parable that we're being prompted to ask is, how is my neighbor? How is my neighbor? How is my neighbor doing? It's easy for us to spend, if you've spent a number of your lives born and raised in the church, going every Sunday, it's easy to keep saying and doing the same thing. The same things that we've said and done for all the years. It's easy to keep apathy. It's easy to stay down, not take the risk of dealing with broken, messy people with real problems of society that are so complicated. It's easier to think a Sunday smile and a quick greeting is all that is required to have people scrambling to come to church. But the truth is people are radically ill with deep social and spiritual problems. And it's also true that a radical stranger from Galilee can heal the hurt, change lives, transform lives, change the light to green for those sitting in the lane that never changes. Because hopelessness was Jesus' specialty. So what would worship and outreach ministering look like at Messiah Lutheran Church, committed fully to the conviction that Jesus has the power to transform us and the lives around us? Where are the unlikely places? Who are the strangers that are being stirred up by the Spirit? What fruits do we bear? And how can we live salvation now? One way of getting to some of those questions, focusing in, might be to simply name. Name one need in this community, right here, where this church is located. Name one need. And ask yourselves, could we meet that need? Do we have resources or gifts or or what is needed? What do we have? What is the need out here? And could there be a meeting of passion and needs that would finally turn the light green for someone, for our neighbor? Many long for more children to be in church. Well, could you open the door to minister to children in this community who may never attend a Sunday morning worship, whose families may never join membership? And yet, when asked, do you have a church? They'll say, yeah, Messiah Lutheran. That's my church. But you may never see that in your membership roles or your finances. Could you do ministry first and accept you may never see the fruits that it bears out, or may rarely hear the stories? How willing are we to turn lanes, move forward to unknown paths mapped out by Jesus Christ? Another thing I hear a lot of among Christian communities is that the church is dying. I hear that a lot. Lots of articles, lots of books, newest and best technique to evangelize the world. Well, I don't think it's true. I know it's not true. The church is not dying. The church is shifting, though. It's changing. It's shifting. But that shifting, that change, is an indication of becoming. And I don't know what it's going to become, but it is becoming. And this isn't the first time the church has become something. The church as we know it today became that. It wasn't that way always. So the church has shifted generation upon generation because the gospel is good news. The gospel is stronger. So we can get up off the floor, and lights can turn green. And part of that is because we are people of the law and gospel, right? The law of life is what bears down on us. It reminds us of our mistakes, our takedowns, our holdbacks, our slams to the floor, our pettiness. And the gospel is of God of grace, of a God who became one of us fully and wholly and completely, who suffered and died and was buried. There's power in believing in the true manifestation and magnificence of an incarnate God. Let us never ignore the power of that, who became one of us, felt pain, suffered, died, then defeated down sin, death, and the devil. It is defeated. It is done. That's the story of salvation that we're called to live out every day. We receive this life-transforming grace, this good news, and then reflect it out into the world. And lights turn green for people. Lives change. So, there's more to being a Christian than what I believe and what I do. Being a Christian is living a transformed life and following the inspirations that we feel to live out what we've experienced through worship or through praise or through service or through prayer. Think of it this way, my story about the light never turning. We're like waiting for that light that's slow to turn green. And it's like pausing to ask those questions. And we may ask, which one am I, the sheep or the goat? How am I doing? Am I doing enough? How many volunteers' hours are required to God? And we work through all of those and we come to that question, how is my neighbor doing? the light turns green. And you want to know why? Because it must. It must. Because the moment you ask that question, how is my neighbor doing? We must move into action. The green light turns green so we can move into action. Can create the fruit of salvation. Can live transformation through knowing Jesus. Amen.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. We believe in one God, Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came.
welcoming God's reign of righteousness and mercy, let us pray with people of every time and place. Almighty God, your merciful rule encompasses all the world. As we gather for worship in safety, we pray for places where the church is persecuted. Watch over your people as they witness to your good news. Lord, in your mercy. Give bountiful pastures, safety, and health to herds, livestock, and all animals. May our care for all of your creation reflect your shepherding love for all that you have made. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for international organizations that shine your light in places of strife. Lead relief and aid workers, leaders and volunteers to seek the lost and provide safety. Lord, in your mercy. Bind up the injured and strengthen the weak, abused, or ill, especially Marilyn Gabrielson, Valerie McKenzie, Melba Nelson, David Goodwin, and Doris Bowman. Give wisdom to counselors, doctors, and nurses, and all in professions that provide healing. Lord, in your mercy. Shepherd your churches to welcome the stranger and immigrant in our midst. Call all your people to welcome, clothe, feed, and visit those in need, just as you have provided for the lost and despairing through the ages. Lord, in your mercy. Give us the hope to which you call us, our glorious inheritance with all your saints. Enrich our lives with the faith and vision of those saints who have died. Lord, in your mercy.
Receive these prayers and the hopes and the concerns of our hearts, O God, as we entrust into your loving care all for whom we pray, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated for this time of sharing of gifts.
Let us pray. Creator God,
the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and joy, that we should in all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of the angels and with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. O God most mighty, O God most merciful, O God our rock and our salvation, hear us as we praise, call us to your table, grant us your life. When the world was a formless void, you formed order and beauty. When Abraham and Sarah were barren, you sent them a child. When the Israelites were enslaved, you led them to freedom. Ruth faced starvation, David fought Goliath, and the psalmist cried out for healing. And full of compassion, you granted the people your life. You entered our sorrows in Jesus, our brother. He was born among the poor. He lived under oppression. He wept over the city. With infinite love, he granted the people your life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to all to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his death, we cry out, "Amen." Celebrating his resurrection, we shout, "Amen." Trusting his presence in every time and place, we plead, "Amen." O God, you are breath. Send your spirit on this meal. O God, you are bread. Feed us with yourself. O God, you are wine. Warm our hearts and make us one. O God, you are fire. Transform us with hope. O God, most majestic. O God, most motherly. O God, our strength and our song, you show us a vision of the tree of life with fruits for all and leaves that heal the nations. Grant us such life, the life of the Father to the Son, the life of the Spirit to our risen Savior, life in you, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
You may be seated. The meal is prepared, and all are welcome to receive this meal of forgiveness. The ushers will indicate when you can come forward. You may kneel or stand along the railings. You'll receive the bread and then either the dark liquid, which is wine, or the light liquid, which is grape juice. And there are gluten-free elements available. Just let your server know. Come, let us eat.
Thank you.
invite you to stand as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in his grace.
Sovereign God, in this meal you give us a foretaste of the great feast to come. Keep us faithful to you, that we, with all your saints, may at length celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb, Jesus Christ our Lord.
You may be seated for announcements at this time. I believe there's a few.
Go and tell. Go ye therefore. Come and see. Go tell it on the mountain. These are all invitations to share the good news. Did you know that the word evangelism means good news? Come and join us next Sunday at the 9:45 to study the book, Me, an Evangelist, and learn that we are all evangelists in our own natural way. Books are available in the church office for $12 each. Come and see.
I want to go next because I don't want to follow the antlers. Okay. That's a hard act to follow. I just want to call your attention to a couple of outreach opportunities we have just right on the other side of those doors. I know it's in the bulletin about Stepping Stone's angel tree, but there are a lot of angel ornaments still left on that tree, and we have to have stuff back in 2 weeks. This is a really worthy cause. Stepping Stones is an organization that helps developmentally disabled adults, and this is an easy thing. Pick up an angel ornament. It has information inside about the person that you can help out, make Christmas a little more cheerful for. So please make those angels come off the tree. And the other thing I noticed this morning is safe to sleep, and you've heard us talk about that. This provides a safe place for women in harm's way to have a safe place to sleep, and they have Christmas cards for anybody who's still sending Christmas cards. They have Christmas cards out there that are really beautiful. I was looking at them on the way in, so please take advantage of those opportunities.
Good morning, everybody. I'm just here to reinforce something that's in your messenger, so you'll be able to take it home and mark it on your calendar. But next Saturday, December the 2nd, we're going to hang the greens, which sounds kind of tough, but it's really a fun thing. We will be decorating the mission hall, setting up the tree here in the sanctuary, and decorating like crazy because Advent is upon us and the Christmas season. I invite all of you to join us Saturday morning. We'll start around 9, and it won't take too long because when everyone comes, many hands make light work. We'll have some refreshments, and we look forward to seeing all of you there. It's a great way to get to know people better, working side by side and building the community of Messiah Lutheran Church. Thank you.
All right. Okay, well, what else is going on that day is the Women's Christmas Brunch and Cookie Exchange at 10 a.m. on the 2nd as well. So you get lots of treats that day, and please bring some cookies.
My name is David Seward. I sing with the Springfield Mid-America Singers. I may have made announcements before. You may have seen the posters that I put up on the doorway. We've never sung here until December 5th, Tuesday night. A whole bunch of people are going to be singing here. Come hear us. 7:30, December 5th.
All right. So there's lots of things going on. Also, call committee nominations are in that little white box with the telephone on the side of it, and you can read about that. There's a job description on sitting there as well. And think offerings will be December 2nd and 3rd. You can read about that. And there is just tons. Oh, new member class also this Thursday at 6. So if you're thinking about joining, please join us that night. And I think that's enough announcements. And I left my blessing over here. I almost have it memorized, but not quite. Please stand as you are able. Receive the benediction. May the Lord walk beside you to comfort you. May the Lord walk above you to watch over you. May the Lord walk behind you to keep you safe. And may the Lord walk before you to show you the way, now and forever. Amen.
Guided by the gospel, we welcome all to worship, make disciples, hunger for ministry, nurture youth, gather resources for growing ministries, offer healing and care to all in need. Go in peace, share the good news. Alleluia.